So, Mr. Bashir, you're going to talk a little bit about Alexander Usyk and his upcoming fight, and also Steve Cullum's going to be fighting Gawaki and the cruiserweight division and your fighter.
I think that the cruiserweight division is a highly underestimated division. It's what the heavyweights were yesterday. In the heyday of the heavyweights, they were, by today's standards, cruiserweights. These guys, most of the guys in the cruiserweight division are very dangerous punchers. Just look to your right, left, in front of you, and back, and you find that most of the guys that's in the cruiserweight division are calculated punchers. They can hurt you with one shot. The guy that we're fighting now, to me, he's the champion. I like to bring my guy into the fight with the knowledge of saying, for instance, that I'm coming in and I'm hungry like the challenger. I don't want to bring the overconfident, arrogant guy into the ring, disrespecting people, because that's when you get hurt. I want my guy to come in hungry like the challenger. And it could be Stephen Cease, Simmons, or Bobo Walker. It doesn't matter. When you come in the ring, you come in the ring with all guns ready for fire. So I'm preparing like I'm preparing for the champion himself. We're not playing around. We're in serious training starting tomorrow morning. You know, and I'm going to go in there and do the best I can to get this guy out of there as soon as possible and get ready for Glowacki. You know, until Stevie Cunningham derails him, I'm getting ready for Glowacki.
Who would you prefer to fight?
Pardon me?
Who would you prefer to fight out of Glowacki and Cunningham?
I'm saying the championship fighter. I don't care which one of them. It could be Left, it could be Stevie, or it could be Glowacki. I don't care. I honestly can say I don't care which one of the guys I face. I'm preparing for whichever one wins that fight. I'm not the kind of trainer that concerns myself with different styles. I just look at the style and I prepare my guy. You know, the old trainers would tell me years ago, when I'm going back to the 50s and 60s, they said it's my job to figure the style out, to figure the guy's style out, and it's your job to go out there and explore and dominate it. You know, I figured it's the guy's style out, and you go out there and you capitalize on what I figured out. So it doesn't matter whether Stevie Cunningham or Glowacki that wins that fight, we're just gonna get ready for the winner, and we're gonna prepare for them the best we can. I'm very, very observant when it comes to the sport of boxing. In fact, I do things that I don't see any other trainers do, and I won't allude to those things that I do. But I'm very, very in-depth when it comes to training, you know? Very, very in-depth. And I'm going to keep on doing that until I can't do it no more. I love the sport of boxing. I love what I do. And I pride myself on being at least one of the best. I consider myself to be one of the best. You know, it's up to the fans and the press and all these other people to say who's the best, but I do consider myself to be one of the best teachers that's out there today. And I know that I'm in a small classroom when it comes to teaching boxing. You know, that's where I'm at on that. But so it doesn't matter who wins the fight, the winner he's got to fight Usyk.
Okay. Well, it should be good when it happens. When you so you're just arriving in the UK now. So of Ukraine now. So when is the fight taking place?
We're gonna be boxing on the 23rd of April.
Mm-hmm.
Here in the Ukraine, and we try to get him out there. By then, we'll know who we're fighting, because Glowacki and Stevie, I think they fight on April 16th.
Yep. But the man for slots, no slip-ups. Could be, I mean, can't afford no slip-ups now.
You know, I realize that.
All right. Okay, alright, so we're gonna change up slightly again. We're gonna ask about your guy, Vladimir Klitschko, Tyson Fury. Well, I had an interview with Tyson Fury on the weekend on the weigh-in of the Blackwell and Eubanks Jr. And I was talking to him about when is he gonna be in the ring with Vladimir, and apparently he hasn't heard anything, but he's a fighter, Tyson said. And I didn't really ask Peter about it, but there's no date been given. On the contract, it says that they can't have a fight. They can't have a fight during this until Klitschko. Klitschko has to be the manager of the fight. If he takes another fight before that, he'll be sued. Same situation like Hasse Rettman and Lennox Lewis. He'd have to go to court. So they're at this point, they're at liberty until Vladimir. So from your end, have you heard anything? And obviously, has Vladimir got to you? And are you going to be in his camp? That's what I'd like to know.
I'll be... We'll let him in Klitschko until the day he hangs him up. You know, we just ain't got that kind of relationship. I saw somewhere on the internet today that Nick Hennessy said that this here fight would probably take place in England in July.
Yeah, that's what they put out, but
in fact, he said it was almost 80% chance that it would take place in England in July.
I think they've put that out there just to keep people at bay. But the when I talk to Fury, Tyson himself, is now, they haven't heard nothing. So I'm asking you on your end.
That's all I've heard.
What, that's glad they may have been in touch with you about coming back into camp?
That's what they... Has Vladimir been in touch with me about coming back into his camp?
Yeah, they're coming back in the camp, preparing them for a fight or anything. Or have you talked to Vladimir about this, about the Fury fight?
I talked to Vladimir... 2 days ago was his 40th birthday, so I talked to him then.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't talk much about the fight itself. He just said he's still working on a date.
Okay, they're still working on a date.
Yeah, I try to talk about other stuff outside of boxing. We talk about boxing when it's top preparing.
Okay, I got you.
Yeah, so.
All right, well, without delving into the camp, you guys going to take that title back? Or it's a silly question, isn't it?
I think Vladimir Klitschko wants to fight. People keep coming saying to me that, well, Vladimir doesn't want to fight no more. He seems not to be out of boxing. But from my experience with him, he seems to want to fight, genuinely. He wants to get back in there. He wants to fight. He wants to prove himself. He's going to have to fight. He's going to have to fight. There's not no deep science, even though the sport is called the sweet science. It's not a deep science about what has to take place for him to win this fight.
No, exactly. It's not. It's not a big secret. More punching up to the front. There's no way around that. There's no way around it. More hard punches have to be thrown. I don't know how he's going to go about that and what style, but he definitely has to throw more. Definitely has to throw more.
Mr. Bashir, me and Ingrid Baylor at TV, we met up on the weekend as well, and we was having a good chat and that. So when do you think, after the Usyk thing, are you gonna? So Josh is fighting Martin. That's just the thing. When do you reckon? Are you gonna come to England at some point, and come to watch the Joshua fight or Dillian fight when they're fighting? Because I remember you said you was thinking about it. Mr. Bashir? Okay.
In Joshua's fight, if I was not working.
No, I'm talking about recently. I'm talking about, are you looking, are they going to be, it seems like if Joshua gets past Martin, maybe Joshua fights another fight, Fury, or, you know, he might fight, try and call out your guy. Are you looking to come to the UK?
I think that Joshua has been thrown into the fire by his own actions.
Oh, really? Okay.
You know, he's in the fire now, and they're not going to let him turn back. They're looking for him to be the next great entity in boxing.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And I think that he's been cast into the fire, sort of like Fernando Vargas was. Fernando Vargas won the title, and he wasn't never... able to have the relaxation to get comfortable with that title. Every time he got into a fight, it was life or death. You know? And Joshua is in that same mode. He's in a situation where he's going to have to fight. Because If he beats Martin, nobody's going to let him rest. Nobody's going to let him rest. He's going to have to fight. And I think that Joshua is comfortable with the idea. I think that he's comfortable, and I think that he expects some things from his own self. And that's not to say that he is going to beat this young man, Martin, you know, because he's tough too. And I don't want to disrespect him by saying that AJ is going to win, you know, because I think that Martin, he wants to prove himself also. So it's going to be a tough fight. I think that AJ is better in a better place to win the fight than Martin. Prince Martin. I think that AJ is in a better place to win. And I'm speaking about comfort, comfort with big fights, comfort with the arena, comfort going in. It means a lot. People say it doesn't mean anything to the bell ring, but a lot of things around the fight means a lot to different fighters. Prince Martin is a big puncher with the left hand. Joshua is a good puncher with both hands. So you got two big guys in there, but I don't expect this fight to go past five rounds. I think that somebody will get caught, and then whoever gets caught, the other guy will finish him inside of five. You know, but if Joshua wins the fight, I think he's comfortable with the idea that he'll have to fight Fury or Wilder or Klitschko. He's comfortable with that. I don't think that he has any pressure on him whatsoever, because he knows that people expect, you know, so many things from him. As the old timers would say, to whom much is given, much is expected. So he's comfortable with that, and going forward, and I think that he's going to be in the fire. He's going to be in the fire. So straight boxing is a strange thing, because, you know, you can have a guy making all kinds of mistakes, like young George Foreman. Young George Foreman made all kinds of mistakes, but he was so strong and so tough mentally and tough with power, nobody paid attention to the fact that he was making mistakes until Muhammad Ali came in. And then everything, Ali pulled his dress up and you saw that he ain't have nothing on, you know?
Mr. Monsieur, I just realised, yeah, you see the guy Alexander Usyk is fighting, it's Stephen Smith, Stephen Simpson. Beach, you know him, what do you Camacho lost to him? What did Camacho got beat by him?
Oh, Stephen Simmons.
Yeah, the Cookie Monster thing, yeah. He's fighting, yeah? Yeah, he's fighting Alexander Usyk, yeah. Yeah, he's fighting Alexander Usyk. The last fight he lost against Jazzy Dickens. You remember that fight? Not Jazzy Dickens, John Lewis Dickinson. So that's the last fight he lost. Yeah, so he's fighting Alexander Usyk, which is pretty good. It should be good.
Yeah, he's
won three in the spin.
He hasn't got a chance.
Yeah, no, he's won three on the spin up and that, so it should be.
He hasn't got a chance.
But Mr. B, yeah.
No chance at all. Not one single chance. There's not one thing in boxing that he can come close to Usyk. Not one thing. Wadi was outboxing him with ease, and Wadi just lost concentration, you know. He's not the most stable of fighters. So if he was a little more stable, he would have beat Simmons easy. So I didn't realize he was fighting Simmons.
Because when I was looking, I was like, who's this guy? And then I looked and I realized, oh, it's Cookie Monster.
He's going to be brave. He's going to be very brave.
Yeah.
You know? And he can punch a little if you stand right there, but if you say his anything like I've seen in box, it's plain sailing. It's kind of plain sailing.
Yeah. Well. Okay. Anything else you want to add to Mr. Bashir? Anything else you want to point at Mr. Bashir?
It's a fight to me. It's a fight. My job is to prepare Usyk for a fight.
Oh, yeah. Well, listen, Mr. Bashir, you're in the camp. You have to take it serious. I'm an outsider. From an outsider, right, I'm expecting Usyk to look good. and then go on to take his world title shot. I'm not expecting Stephen Simmons to give Usyk any problems. That's from the outside. You're in a camp. You can't look at it the same way I there's no way. Right? From the outside, I'm expecting you guys to put this guy aside. Not easily, not in a couple of rounds. You're gonna have to work for your stuff. But I don't envision no problems. I just don't envision any problems.
Right.
Agreed. Agreed. Agreed, man. But you know what, like Mr. Vichier,
your assessment is very comforting.
Yeah, no stone unturned. Like obviously cover all the boxers. I just realized, you know, it comes to bases that what happened this weekend. That people need to understand this sport is very, very dangerous. And we understand all the great stuff and all the history. This sport is very dangerous. If you don't have people around you who can look out for your interest and train you, obviously the kid was trained, prepared. But there's certain things, yeah, that you know, people need to, the telltale signs of what's going on, you know. And not necessarily you have to be knocked on your back or knocked down to be hurt. There's other signs to show that a fighter is hurt, but hopefully Stephen Simpson don't get hurt too badly, because Usyk can throw some punches. I'm probably looking for like three rounds. It's lucky if it even goes three rounds, to be honest with you.
No, I don't think it's going to be a blowout. It could be even eight, but I don't think Usyk. I don't think Usyk struggles in this.
No.
I don't think he struggles.
Brave, strong guy coming over. And
you never know. You never know. Like, you know, Mr. Bashir's got to keep his man on his toes, and it's like you said, it's a fight. It's a fight.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you never know. Guy might come in and try to with a Buster Douglas mentality. You know.
Yeah. This is Stephen Simmons' biggest opportunity ever in his career.
Yeah, it's knock off the number one contender for the championship, isn't it? So he gets a title
I believe to this day that Buster Douglas legitimately was knocked out by Mike Tyson. I thought he lost that fight on the long count. But however, he got up and he won the fight, so I got to respect that too.
Yeah.
But I do think that count was a long count. I thought Buster Douglas lost that fight by TKO.
Yeah.
I agree. Let's change it up quickly, right?
Octavio Moran. Yeah, that count, man.
Yeah, that's the referee. Yeah, let's
change. Do you think like that? We go on after this here. Okay. But does anybody share my sentiment?
No, I at the time I did.
Tyson was robbed.
Yeah, but
he fell down, right? With the uppercut, that right hand uppercut. He went down. And the count went on for ages. The count went on for ages. And he should have been counted out. But it wasn't to be. It wasn't to be.
Yeah, Tyson could have jumped on him and finished him, but that was the end of the round, didn't it? So that was it. So, but you know, that's what happened. But, you know, if we got a guy hurt, usually go in and finish it, but it wasn't to be. But I want to change up real quick, yeah? Let's talk about PEDs in the sport. So Lucas Brown has recently fought Chagaev over there in, I think it was in Russia, whatever. And anyway, after the fight, they found out he got PEDs in his system.
Who?
Lucas Brown.
Oh my goodness.
You don't know? Yeah, this is news to you, yeah? So, yeah, they got PEDs in his system. They on VADA, they test on his A sample, that they found something in his system which is banned on their list. He's pleading, you know, pleading the fifth, saying he don't know nothing about it, and he wants to take another test. He has to pay for the B sample, but obviously, a lot of people thinking he's innocent. Now, the thing is, when Anton Tarbar had it, everyone jumped in and called him a drug cheat. When Lamont Peterson had it, he's a drug cheat. Guillermo Jones is a cheat, this, that, the other. But Lucas is all right. He's a good guy. And because, you know, maybe they like him, it's a different thing. But these sort of things, is it rampant in the sport? What's your take on your first take of just hearing this? Did you see the fight as well?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead then. Yeah, so that's what's happened.
I think that until the powers that be put their foot down, you're always going to have the problem. In Saudi Arabia, if you get caught stealing, you lose a hand. All right?
Mm.
If you have sex with a woman that's not your wife, you lose your life. okay? I said that to say that you gotta let people understand, make them understand what they have to lose. And then maybe you won't have such a rampant proceeding thereafter. If the powers that be say if you get caught using PEDs, you lose your license for life. Because if you're using drugs to enhance your ability to fight, that becomes a weapon. You become a weapon. So until the powers that be put their foot down and say, hey, if you're caught cheating, you're out for life. Panama Lewis, they excluded him from the sport for life for tampering with gloves. For tampering with the gloves. So how much more dangerous is tampering with the gloves than somebody using PEDs? Hmm. You see what I'm saying? So everybody's got to be made to feel the authority of the powers that be. If you get caught using PEDs, you're banned from the sport for life.
That's, well, the PED he apparently used is to do with cutting down, it's to do with losing weight. And it basically burns the fat and stuff like that. But he's a heavyweight.
Clint Boucheron, the diuretic.
Yeah, that's it. It burns weight, so it keep you in shape and stuff like that. So that's the thing he took. But you know, that's what they found.
I don't care.
You don't care.
Steal it. I'm not gonna be right. And like, you know, like, I'm not being funny. I'm not gonna cover up my thoughts on it. Like, a lot of people who keep saying, oh, Lucas is a nice guy, there's got to be something wrong. But they don't give everybody that same, you know, leeway. I don't like the hypocrisy. It doesn't matter if you're nice or not. Until he's cleared, he's guilty. And that's that.
Yeah, I agree. You know, you can't tolerate it. It's a no tolerance. You there?
Yeah,
they keep saying he's a nice guy.
No, there has to be a policy in boxing. No tolerance. You do it once, you're out.
Mm-hmm.
You do it and life. You can't do it again, right?
You're breaking up, Mr. Bishir. You're breaking up, Mr. Bishir. So I don't know if you're moving around or something.
Yeah, I'm not moving around.
Okay, go ahead. It sounds all broken up in that. Try and carry on talking. I don't know. The connection sounds a bit funny. Go ahead.
I think there has to be a clear and stern method sent for those participants in the sport. And the court using illegal substances, because I'm sick and tired of it. You're destroying the sport, you know. You can't win something on your own accord, then you don't need to be in the sport. If you get caught using banned substances once, not twice, you're banned for life and you're not even allowed to work in a corner ever again. And then you'll see things change. But as long as my say, oh, you're going to be suspended for a year, 2 years, then they'll keep doing it. Because that's all I got to lose is 2 years. But if you tell them that they're going to be banned for life and you won't even be able to work in and around the sport, the same way they did Panama Lewis, Jose Resto, they banned them for life. They couldn't even work in the corner. They couldn't even work in the corner.
Yeah.
They couldn't even plot their trade. They came down on them so hard, and it's not fair to them for people to be allowed to do the same thing and not be penalized.
Of course. And they keep saying, oh, he was spiked. But when the English guy, not England, the Asian guy from the UK, Galahad, said he was spiked, he didn't get that kind of sympathy. I mean, look, the bottom line is, you are accountable for what goes inside your body and what passes out. So if you were spiked, then you've got to watch who you're taking water from. And stuff like that, you know, that...
Well, again, it boils down to the boxing. You surround yourself with people that can be trusted not to do that kind of stuff.
Right.
You can't say somebody must have put something in my water. Exactly. In Vladimir Klitschko's camp, in Lennox Lewis's camp, which camps I was in extensively, nobody got near the water. Nobody got near the food. Because they both had people watching and guarding that water and guarding that food. That it wasn't a chance.
Exactly.
We're talking about some Mission Impossible stuff where you had to cut a hole in a cement floor and break into a locker room and, you know what I'm saying? You wasn't getting near the water or the food. No, not a chance. So it's up to the boxer to surround himself with people who are trustworthy so that he won't have to have that problem. But you can't come back and when the test come back, say, hey man, you got something in your blood. But I don't know who did it. Really? Really? You're running that kind of camp? Your camp is that raggedy, you don't know who's around the water? Get out of here.
Ragged, you know. Hey, we're listening to this machine, yeah? He trains himself and he cuts corners on trainers. So this is what I was thinking, like, you know, with the theories. And now when I talked to Peter, talking with Peter and Tyson, I asked him about the water, why, you know, coming over to your, obviously coming over to the Ukraine. They said, we don't trust anything. We bring our own water, bring our own thing. We can't allow anything to happen. Not like it was going to happen, but we couldn't allow it. Lucas, on the other hand, I'm not sure if he did that, you know. He's so concentrating on, you know, trainers and not really having a trainer. I don't even know who the trainer is in his corner. And them sort of things happen.
In the Klitschko care, we got people who sleep with the water.
You see? Oh, you guys, you see? There you go. See it there?
We carry the water from point A to point B to point C to the ring. And we got people who sleep with the water.
Wow. You guys do it as well? Wow, man. You don't trust no one, eh?
No. Not when it comes to all of the marbles. No.
Mm-mm.
You know, this is what you have to do, you know, to protect your guy.
This professional, you know, sport. This is, there's a lot of money at stake.
Right.
You know?
So we got a person whose job is to sleep and walk with that water. Wherever the water goes, he goes. Right? And it's not, you know, it's not going to... Anything happened to what's not going to happen. It's not because of the war, that's for sure. You have to be.
I don't know. Do you think Vladimir was drugged against Lamont Brewster? It might be a bit before your time, but a lot of people say Vladimir.
It was one fight before I joined this team. All right?
Yeah.
I don't know what happened. I don't know. Some people say he was drugged. Hey, I don't know. I don't know what happened.
All speculation. All we're under the bridge.
Yeah, until somebody proves it, it's speculation.
Yeah.
I think that Lamont Brewster came to fight, and he won the fight. Fair and square. Regardless of what happened during, you know, I don't know what happened again. Only God and the person that did something would know, but I don't know.
Yeah. That's an honest answer. That's an honest, fair answer.
Yeah, that's all. Nobody can say, hey, son, I was drugged in the fight. He was blasted, Lamont Brewster. Yeah. And Lamont Brewster took everything, every single thing that Vladimir Klitschko had to offer, and he came back like a true champion. And he won that fight. As far as my thinking goes, you know. As far as my thinking goes, he won the fight, fair and square.
Mm. Yeah.
You know? Because he took a heck of a beating leading up to that. He took a heck of a beating.
Let's take some big punches for the first three rounds or so.
Certainly he did. And like a true champion, he came roaring back. And that had to be one of the biggest victories, man. That was a big victory for him.
It was massive, man. It was massive.
He got up off the floor and came back in regards to why the fight was stopped, because Vladimir was out of gas or whatever. He won the fight, and he should be given credit and respect for that.
Yep. Showed a lot of heart, man.
Nowadays, you know, a boxer just will just leave a trainer. Oh, he messed up, he got to go. You know, instead of trying to work it out, saying maybe it was my fault, maybe I did something wrong. Oh man, but the sport is not used to what it used to be. It's tough now because of the mindset in the sport.
Yeah.
You got 1,000 Johnny come latelys in the sport that claim that they know the sport. I was working with a young man a few weeks ago, and his manager, whoever the guy was, I really didn't get clarity. The guy said that he didn't feel that I was acting in the best interest of his fighter. So I said, well, what did I do to lead you to think that? He said, oh, just the way you're acting in the locker room, you're acting standoffish, you're acting distant. I said, sir, I was hired to fix cuts. I was hired as a cut man. What do you want me to do? Hold his wiki? I got no business talking to the fighter. I didn't even know the fighter that well.
Yeah.
I stayed away. You know, I stayed away. I sat in the locker room. I talked with a couple of people I knew in the sport. And the guy claims that I was acting standoffish. What did you want me to do?
Right. I mean, because if he wanted you to participate with a little more, more attention, he should ask you that. He should ask you, could you...
The role that I was assuming was a second.
Yeah.
Cut man. And that was it. I mean, I don't know what else. And I wrapped the guy's hands. So, I mean, what more do you want me to do? You know, well, I don't like the way you act. And I said, excuse me, how old are you, man? He said, what? I said, how old are you? He said, I'm 44. I said, you're 44? He said, yeah, I'm 44. I said, I got 2 sons older than you. I got a son damn near the same age as you. And you fucking punk, you're going to tell me that I'm fucking... You better get your ass out of my face. I lost it, you know, I lost it. I got to work on that. I lost it. When I should have just stayed cool, but I got so upset with him. I said, you better get your ass away from me.
Basically, you was trying to not step out of line in the guy's box.
I was trying to not step out of line.
Yeah. Yeah.
And here comes this bird that's going to accuse me of being standoffish. I was acting professional by not being up in the fighter's face, up in his head, up in his space. Stay away. It's a fight. This guy's getting ready to go on a fight. I got no business saying nothing there.
Yeah.
And you're talking to me like that. I said, you don't know nothing about boxing. You don't know nothing about boxing. You need to stay away from me. Get out of my face. Pay me my money, get out of my face. You're the one that's unprofessional. You're the one that doesn't know boxing. Yeah, you act like I'm supposed to go there and have a love fest with the guy. Well, yep. I said, no. You know, he pissed me off so bad, he can't... Oh, my goodness. I haven't got that angry in so long because I've seen so many clowns and bozos in this sport that sometimes I lose it, you know? I went to a press conference one night, Stevie Cunningham's, I think the second fight with Adam Eck.
Yeah.
And Steve was a fight that I thought Stevie won.
Yeah.
And I thought he won the first one. I thought he won those fights.
I thought he did as well.
I thought he won both.
And it was some guy, it was some reporter in there. I don't know who he was writing for or nothing, but it was reporting. It was in the post-fight press conference. And everybody was having input in the conversation. It wasn't like it was just the reporters that was asking questions. And I said, I can't understand how Adamac won 8. He won 8 out of the 12 rounds. I said, are you serious? The guy turns around, looks at me and says, who are you? I didn't know he was talking to me, so I kept talking. He said, sir. He said, who are you? So I said, who am I? I said, I'm a trainer. He said, who? So I said, who are you? You're asking me questions. Who are you? Whatever forgot his name was. He's a writer for a newspaper somewhere in the state, somewhere in Trenton, New Jersey or something. Told me his name and said, if you're not a reporter, you should just keep quiet. Oh my God. I said, let me tell you something.
You must.
I walked through the crowd, I walked up to him, I said, what did you just say to me? If you say that again, I'm gonna pick you up and I'm gonna dump you in a garbage can. I'm gonna dump you in a garbage can. Say it again. And the whole room got quiet. The promoter, everybody got quiet. I said, you got some goddamn nerve talking to me like that. And everybody in here has some input in this conversation. You're gonna tell me to keep quiet? And you never threw a punch in your life, you punk motherfucker, you better keep quiet. And that's what I try to guard against. I try to guard against losing my temper, because I think that there's so much racism in the sport of boxing that people think that they can say what they want to say when it comes to a black person. Yeah. No, you can't. Because they don't realize that black people have gone through so much BS to get where they are, that they just get fed up with that kind of nonsense. I know I do. I see it over and over and over. You know, the racism that persists in this sport.
Yeah.
You know? And like I said, Johnny Come Lately can come in the door, and because they have white skin, they can say or do what they want to. You know? And I have white friends that agree with me. White friends that agree. You know, because I stand up to it. I said, man, you just get your ass out of here. What are you talking about? Shut up. You got some nerve to my shut up. You ain't never even had an argument talking about shut up. I slap you in your face. Get out of here. You know, I lose it like that day, and I don't like losing that day. I'm so cool and calm. You know, when I'm working with boxers, I'm cool and calm because I say, I get across my message easily and clearly. You know, that's why boxing goes so smoothly as a trainer. But there are those times where people won't cross the line with me. Just because I'm an easygoing guy doesn't mean that I'm some kind of punk. I grew up in the streets. And most black people grew up in the streets. You see two sides of them, you know?
Yeah.
You go reaching for it, you're gonna probably get more than what you expected, you know?
Yeah, definitely so. So, you would know, more than us. Like, Is the racism within the press and within boxing camps, is it still really bad in America and in Europe? Is still really bad?
I don't think that the people in the training camps, the whites, blacks, Latinos, Asians in the training camp, I think the training camp people, for the most part, get along very well, and the world can look in on those people and say, this is how the world should be. Because when you're in a camp with somebody 4 or 5 weeks at a time, you get to know them, they become family, and the racial barriers seem to dissipate, you know?
Yeah.
The racial barriers is not a problem. It's just like one family, you know. You have the usual spats, but it never boils over to anything where racism is a part of it. You know, the world can look at people in boxing training camps and say, wow, these people get along so well, why can't the world get along like that? I don't think that's the problem. I think it's the outsiders. I think it's when we get to the fight site, the week of the fight and stuff, then you start feeling the racism, how you're treated, you know?
Yeah.
How the levels of respect changes at different standpoints. You know, you might see a person who gets this much more credit, this much more respect, as opposed to that person getting it, you know? I see different things during, especially fight week, you see all kinds of people who are not even connected to boxing, that's around boxing. They're part of the television crew, they're part of this crew, that crew, this crew, and it clicks. They're different cliques, different camps, you know, all related to getting this here broadcast. So that's when you see and experience the racism there.
Yeah.
I don't think that most of the fans in boxing, I don't think that they're racist. I think boxing is just a family that's want to see good fights. So I don't see the people in boxing as racist. I just see the people around boxing. A lot of stuff is related to boxing. It's racist. And I don't like it. I don't like it. I've dealt with this all my life, being born in 1951. I've dealt with racism all my life. And when I see it, I don't like it. DJ Boxy live here. DJ Boxy live here.
Buster Douglas knocked him out. Buster Douglas, the fat bump, the legend. I mean,
yo, this is Chris Caban chilling with my man DJ Boxing Live, one of the hottest, dopest boxing channels on YouTube. Check him out.
Boxing Beats and Rise on the EJ Live YouTube channel.
He was the number 10 rating contender, and he had never been knocked down. And Sonny destroyed his mouth. But Thea lost most of his teeth, basically with one or two left hooks.
Oh, shit, boy. What was look at kids sleeping like Manny Pacquiao?
EJ Boxing Live here. EJ Boxing Live here.